Hi guys, this is Amar and welcome to Amar Tech Stuff. So guys, in this video, we are going to focus on the part 2 of top 10 OSPF interview question and answers. In part 1, we saw from question number 1 to question number 5. So the friends who have not watched that video can watch that video. I'll paste the link for that video in the description section of this video, so you can refer that. So guys, let's start with question number 6, timers in OSPF. What are the timers in OSPF? So guys, as you all are aware that in OSPF, between the OSPF neighbors, some messages are exchanged, hello messages, which are the keep alive messages, which are exchanged between the routers. For example, like R1 and R2, so the two OSPF routers, and they are neighbor of each other. So they'll exchange some keep alive messages, which are hello messages in OSPF. So hello timers basically decide how often these hello packets will be exchanged between these two routers. So that are the hello timers. And in case like R1 is not receiving the hello packets from R2, or the either case where R2 is also not receiving any hello packets from R1, so this OSPF routers basically wait for a certain amount of time before declaring the OSPF neighbor as dead neighbor. So that time is the dead timer. So OSPF decides this hello and dead timers basically on the type of the network. Okay, so like if it is a broadcast network, then the timers will be like hello timer will be 10 seconds and the dead timer will be 40 seconds. Hello timers and dead timers, like dead timers are always 4 times that of hello timers. And in case the network is a non-broadcast network, then the hello timer will be 30 seconds and the dead timer will be 4 times of that, that is 120 seconds. So guys, you need to remember this values, this values, like for broadcast network it is 10 and 4 times of that it is 40. So 10 is the hello timer and 40 is the dead timer. And from non-broadcast network, the hello timers is 30 and 4 times of that is 120 seconds. So you have to remember this, 120 seconds is the dead timer for non-broadcast network. So guys, do remember these values. This is a very critical question which is often asked in interviews. Question number 7, what is the criteria to form OSPF neighborship? How I remember is this, is that there are certain parameters which needs to be matched. And this certain parameters I remember like this, A and TP. Okay, so this A stands for area. A stands for area. So if you have two routers, R1 and R2. So this R1 and R2, both these routers should be in the same area. So that is their area ID should match with each other. That is, if R1 is in area, say 200, then R2 should also be in area 200. The network mark should match. The network marks, now for example, this is the link which is getting connected between R1 and R2, and the subnet marks or the network marks for this is /30. Then for this interface, it should be /30. Then only neighborship will be formed. The timers, this hello timer and dead timer should match. If in case hello timers and dead timers are manipulated in this R1, then the same need to be changed or manipulated on R2 as well. P is the password. So the password should also match. If this is an optional parameter again to form neighborship, let's R1 is, we have configured certain password on R1 for OSPF neighborship, then on R2 also same password should be configured. So guys, always remember that this 4 parameters should match. A and TP. A stands for area, T is the N is the network marks, T is the timers, and P is the password. So I always remember this, I always remember like A and TP, so it becomes very easy while answering or remembering this answer. Question number 8, what are the external routes in OSPF? So guys, whenever routes are redistributed from a different routing protocol or from a different OSPF process into OSPF, these routes are known as external routes. Like if you have a certain OSPF domain, okay, which is having certain process. Okay, and this OSPF is domain is connected to and some EIGRP domain or to some other OSPF process. Then the routes which are going to propagate from or which are going to get redistributed from this another routing protocol or from another OSPF process into the OSPF domain, into your domain OSPF domain, then these routes are known as external routes, because these are the routes which are came from externally, which are redistributed. So they are known as external routes, and these routes are propagated as LSA5 in OSPF domain. Okay. So this is again a question which I have faced not much, but 2 or 3 times in my interviews. Question number 9, what is the stub area in OSPF and what is the advantage of it? Guys, stub area is the area in which LSA5 will not propagate. As I told that LSA5 are the external routes. So for example, like I have an area 100, okay, and this area is having only one exit point. Okay, this particular ABR, it has only one exit point. It is only connected to the another area via this router only. It is only one exit point. Then this area should be made stub, because since it is having only one exit point. So once you make this area as a stub area, external LSS, that is LSA5, will not propagate in this area. And what ABR will do is ABR will propagate a default route in all the internal routers. We will be having some internal routers in this area. So it will be propagating and it will generate default route on all the internal routers of the stub area, which is pointing towards the ABR. Now this is for the connectivity. So this is the stub area. Now what is the advantage of making any area stub? Because since this area is having only single exit point, there's no need that LSA5 should get propagated in this. If you want to communicate with those routes, then they have a default route pointing towards ABR. So that is the advantage of making an area stub. Because unnecessarily this router will be processed with those external routes which are not required, and if they required it, then ABR is there for connectivity. What is DR and BDR in OSPF? Guys, in OSPF, when it comes to a multi-access network, OSPF behaves a bit differently. It actually goes into election of DR and BDR. To explain this question, guys, what you can do is you can draw a diagram in your interview and show your interviewer that you have a complete understanding of this question, because this is a very, very, very important question. So what you can do is you can draw a multi-access network. So I'll just draw a multi-access network having, say, 5 routers. So this is a multi-access network where each and every client can reach each other. That is, each and every router can reach each other. So this is R1, R2, R3, R4 and R5. Okay. Now consider there is a network over here and this link goes down. Now when this link goes down, what R3 will do is R3 will send an update to its directly connected router. Now in this network, in this subnet, R3 is having 4 directly connected routers, that is R1, R2, R4 and R5. So R3 will send update to R5, R4, R2 and R1. Again, what R1 will do is it will again generate another update. Since it has received an update, it will also send the update to its directly connected routers. So it will send to all other routers. R2 will also do the same thing. R4 will also do the same thing. R5 will also do the same thing. So because of this, because of n single update, number of updates are propagated in that particular network, which will result into huge amount of traffic and chaos in that network. Now to eliminate this in OSPF, how OSPF works in multi-access network is that it will elect a DR and a BDR. Now DR is the router with the highest OSPF priority, and by default all routers have priority 1. Now if all routers are having the same priority, then the election goes on the router ID, which is unique. So each and every router will have a unique router ID, and the router which is having the highest router ID will become DR, and the second highest router ID router will become BDR. For example, in this pattern, I'll just draw this diagram again. R1, R2, R3. R4 and R5. Okay. So for example, like this router is having the highest router ID, then this router will become DR, that is designated router. And if this R2 router is having the second highest router ID, then this will become BDR, that is backup designated router. And in case this network goes down, what R3 is going to do is, R3 is going to send update to only DR and BDR, not to this DR other. Now this router will be DR other, R4 and R5, even R3 will be DR other. So it is not going to send update to DR others, that is R4 and R5. It will only send to R1 and R2 since they are DR and BDR. Now this update is going to be sent on a multicast address 224.0.0.6. Now DR will listen to this update and DR will propagate or pass on this update to DR others, that is to R4 and R5, on a multicast address 224.0.0.5. So in this way, the update are not repeated. There's no huge amount of traffic created, no chaos created in multi-access network. So this is how OSPF behaves, the different behavior of OSPF on multi-access network, and they elect DR and BDR to eliminate huge amount of traffic and chaos in the network. So guys, this is again a very important question, which is almost asked in each and every interview if you are facing OSPF interview. So do answer these questions very correctly, guys. I've tried my best to give you the 10 best question and answers which I have faced over the years while giving interview of OSPF. So guys, I hope you have liked this video. If you really like this video, please do share this video, comment on this video, please do subscribe to my channel Amar TechStup, which will actually encourage me to make more and more videos on networking stuff. So guys, thank you for watching this video. Have a nice day and best of luck for your interviews.